Hi everyone, welcome to the 10th video for the quantitative methods course, and in this video I'll be talking about how to set up panel data models and specifically how to choose between fixed and random effects and how to interpret those models. As before, we'll be loading up the data set that we've been working with so far, but if we actually open up the data set and inspect it, we see that there's multiple observations for the same firms. Firms are indicated by the GV key variable for different years. What this implies is that actually we do have panel data. So we've been running models that are cross-sectional models on panel data. So it doesn't really take much advantage of the fact that we have observation for the same firm over time, time being year in our data set. And the way you can have Stata recognize this fact is by using the xtset command. And there you need to fill in what's the identifier. That needs to be a number. So in this case, it's GV key, which is a numeric variable, and the time variable, that's year. And if we then run xtset GV key year, it will show you that Stata now knows, okay, this is a panel data set. Specifically, the panel variable was the GV key. Stata will note it's unbalanced. This implies that there are firms that are not in every single year for our data set. And there's the time variable, which was year in our case, which runs from 2010 to 2016. And Stata knows that this is with gaps. So there are some firms that are there in 2010, but not in 2011, but then again in 2012, for example. And we have one unit of time between our year variable. So 2010, 2011, 2012, increments of one. So now Stata knows that this is a panel data set and it has correctly accounted for this. And this implies that we can now use a number of commands which typically start with xt. So commands with xt at the start are panel data commands. So for example, we can run xtdes. This is the panel data version of the describe command. And then you get a whole bunch of information. For example, we can now see the number of unique firms in our data is almost 13,000, and we have 7 time periods. 2010 through 2016, which you can see here. You can also see how many firms occur just once in the data. You see here, for example, that's less than 5%. 25% or more occur 3 or less times. Most firms occur 6 times or less, and a pretty substantial set still occurs 7 times, which in our case implies in every single period in our data set. This table in particular is very nice because it shows the specific pattern for every firm. So we see here almost 6,100 firms occur in every single year. You see 7 numbers here. A 1 indicates that the firm is in that year. A dot indicates it's missing. So almost 47% of our data are in every single year. That's quite nice. 595 firms occur only in the first 2 years, but not in the later years. 591 only occur in the very first year, etc., etc. So this gives you a sense of, okay, what's the nature of our panel data, which is very nice to see. Next, we will run some regressions where we try to explain the value of acquisitions based on cache. So let's use the xtsum command for ch and aqc, cache and acquisitions. This top row here is essentially the same as what we've seen already. So this is the overall average. This is just what we've seen when you just use the regular summarize command. But we can also see, okay, how much variation is there within firms over time and between firms. So this one is how much variation is there between firms, how much variation is there within firms in these two variables. Typically, if you do a descriptive statistics table for panel data, you would still only record or show this one. But still, it's good to have this information if asked for. Then to decide, okay, which regression model should I use? When you do OLS regression, quite commonly you need to make the decision between fixed effects regression and random effects regression. And to do that, we need to do what they call the Hausmann test, which we will also discuss in class. In Stata, you need to do this without the robust standard errors at first, but then we can use the xtreg command. So again, this is the regression command that we've seen before, but the xt meaning panel version of it. And we're going to run regression of acquisitions on cache. we first add the option FE to indicate fixed effects, and then RE to indicate random effects. And we're going to store them respectively as FE and RE. We can call this whatever we want. So running those two models, we can then do Hausmann FE RE. And as we will have discussed in class, if it's significant, it would point towards needing to use a fixed effects model. If it's insignificant, so for example, this p-value being 0.5, then you would need to do a random effects model. But it's significant here, so we'll do fixed effects. So running then xtreg with the two variables, the FE option, and now the VCE robust, we get our real final model, and that's this. So this is a fixed effect regression with robust standard errors. And actually the interpretation doesn't really change. This is still a linear model. So a one unit change in cache lowers acquisitions by this much. And this is statistically significant. You do see some other information. So for example, this is what we've seen already before. There's some firms that occur just once in the data. The maximum number of times a firm occurs is 7, so in every single year. And on average, firms occur 4.8 times. So that's just some descriptives. The overall R-squared, what you see here, is the same in terms of its concept as what we've seen so far. But now we also see how much of the variation within firms are we explaining, so not that much, and how much of the variation between firms are we explaining. Typically, if you have a descriptive or a regression results table, you would report the within R-squared. Now, the nice thing about panel data, and that's kind of the key benefit, or one of the key benefits, is that we can include what they call lagged versions of our variables. Specifically, we can now, for example, say, predict acquisitions, not by cache in the current year, but by cache in the last year. And you can do this by adding L dot in front of the variable. So let's do that. So we run the fixed effects regression we did before. That's now also control for year and lagged cache. So now this shows that cache in the year before the focal year actually doesn't have an effect on the acquisitions. So it shows mainly, given what we've seen just now, that cache in the current year affects acquisitions, not so much cache in the prior year. You do see now some other things change. We see that there's at most 6 observations. This is because for every lag that you include, so if we go back 1 year, you lose 1 year of data. If you go back 2 years, you will lose 2 years of data, etc. So that's what we can see here. Now we control for, or we include cache, lagged cache, and even 2 years back for cache. And you see actually some interesting patterns that we don't have time to delve into, but you see cache in the current year negatively relates to the number of money spent on acquisitions. 1 year back has a slightly positive effect, and 2 years back has a negative effect again. Again, the interpretation in and of itself is the same. So a one unit change in cache for the current year leads to this change. One unit change in cache 1 year ago for this much, etc. But this is how you can include lags. So 1 year lag is L dot, 2 year lag is L2 dot, 3 year lag would be L3 dot, etc. Vice versa, you can also include what they call forward versions of the variable. This means that, for example, we can run this one here, which will have as the outcome variable the acquisition spent 1 year in the future, and then the cache observation in the current year, and the year dummies in the current year. Typically, people would use the lags, but it's good to know you can also use forward versions of the variables. Just to show you how fixed effects works, it's essentially the same as just including a dummy variable for every single firm. So we see here, if I just run our original model here, that the coefficient is minus 0.0135. And if we run a normal regression model with acquisitions as the outcome, dummies for every single GV key variable and cache, it will take very long. So I won't run this right now completely, but it will be exactly the same coefficient as what you see here. So the main difference is that the xtreg command is a bit smarter and it's much faster. You might get some errors specifically when you do the Hausmann test. So I do want to show what you can do to fix those. So let's say instead of explaining acquisitions, we had wanted to explain gross profits as a function of acquisitions and cash. We can again do then a fixed effects and a random effects regression without the standard robust standard errors. And if we now try the Hausmann test, we actually get this error here. It's saying that the chi-square statistic is smaller than zero, as you can see here, and that this doesn't meet the assumptions for the Hausmann test. It recommends some alternative tests, but there's actually quite an easy fix to solve this, and specifically that's doing the Hausmann with the option sigma more or sigma less. And indeed, if we run this, you just get the same test as what we've done before. If you type in Stata help Hausmann, you can see some more information on these two tests, but I just wanted to show that here because this error is quite common and you can quite easily solve it in this way. It is important to keep in mind though that errors, they don't pop up for no reason, so this might indicate that there's something not quite good with your data. In this case, it's very likely because our variables are so extremely skewed. Both gross profits, acquisitions, and cash are very skewed, so that might require transforming them. You can also try excluding specific variables, etc. But I would always advise you to start from theory. I wouldn't drop acquisitions simply because then the Hausmann test wouldn't work. But nevertheless, sometimes, as you can see, there are quite easy fixes that are not as dramatic as dropping variables. That's all what I wanted to show for panel data regression. In the next few videos, we'll finish up the video tutorials by looking into what they call nonlinear regression models. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you soon.